Okay, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Franklin. I'm one of the two co-founders of Northern California Spinal Cord Injury Foundation, also known as NorCal SCI. Welcome to tonight's presentation on upper extremities activities or therapies using an exoskeleton. We're really excited to bring you this presentation. We're actually quite honored that the founders of the company approached us about the idea of sharing their device with you, and we're pleased to have this opportunity. So a couple of housekeeping items. Everybody has been muted so that we could eliminate any kind of background noise during the presentation. So don't be wondering. In case if you have any questions, and we do welcome, and actually we are counting on questions and feedback to tonight's presentation. You can use the chat feature on your screen. You can also use the raise hand button on your screen to acknowledge, to at least get a hold of me, my attention, so that you have something to say. But primarily use the chat feature if you can. And we have a Q&A session after the conclusion of the presentation, which should take about 12 minutes or so. And we'll be asking our presenters all the questions. So that's one thing. And then the second thing is, as we always do, we record all of these presentations. So if you need to step out for any reason, don't be worried about that, missing out on anything. We will be making this video available. But again, really one of the big purposes of tonight's presentation is to engage with you as a spinal cord injury community and provide some feedback that the company is seeking as they are working towards rolling out this product to the marketplace. So that's about it. So without further ado, let me introduce the speakers and the presenters. The primary presenter is going to be Robbie Breedlove. He's a product director at the company. He graduated from Oklahoma State University with a degree in physiology with and has 10, over 10 years of experience with medical robotics startup companies. Prior to joining Harmonic Bionics, Robbie held positions such as director of sales at Neosis, a first-to-market robot in the dental industry, and also director of training at Mazor Robotics, a first-to-market robotic device for spine and brain surgery. Yes, exciting stuff. He's a firm believer in patient advocacy and approaches his role as the product director at the Harmonic with a people-first mentality. Also joining us is the CEO of Harmonics. His name is Christopher Prentice. He's a West Point graduate with a master's degree in business administration as well as healthcare administration. He has over 20 years of medical device experience in both large strategic healthcare companies and successful startup companies. Prior to his position as VP of Commercial Integration at Medtronic, he was CEO of Mazor Robotics and Chief Commercial Officer of Mazor Robotics, companies that were later acquired by Medtronic in December of 2018. So I'm very happy to present Robbie, who's going to take us through a demonstration of the exoskeleton for upper extremities device. Robbie.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Franklin. I appreciate the warm welcome. And I would be remiss, and I missed on this. I was apologizing to my coworker here. I didn't send Rohit's his bio, but Rohit's going to be working with us today on the demonstration, and he is the director of R&D. So if we start to get into any of those really, really technical or intricate questions, I've got my bases covered. Thank you, everybody, for joining. I'm sure probably all across the country, maybe even the world, some of these names. It's a real incredible opportunity, and we're incredibly humbled to have the opportunity to present to the NorCal Spinal Cord Injury Association. This is one of our larger demonstrations, and unique in that it's to a variety of different audiences, you know, from potential patients to caregivers. So it's a real really thankful to have this opportunity. So kind of a brief introduction first before I get into the technology. So Harmonic Bionics is the name of the company, and we're developing technology that will assist in upper body movement and rehabilitation. So the system that you see behind me here that I'm going to demonstrate today is not currently in commercial use. However, it will be in 2021. So right now it's still under development. It's going to be piloted in 2021 at select centers across this country, across the United States, excuse me. While it's in these centers, what we're going to be doing is investigating the patients that Harmony technology applies to and how the system should be used for each of those patients. So I know we have a variety of different patients presenting with different ailments on the call. So I'm going to deliver a presentation as if I was delivering it to a caregiver. And as Franklin mentioned, it would be really wonderful if we could receive feedback, questions, any kind of experience you may have had, whether it was technology or in your rehabilitation, whatever kind of question, there's nothing that's out of bounds here. So I just want to make sure that we drive that part home. And as he mentioned, in the chat column or however you guys can get that question across. So with that said, I'm going to go ahead and jump in. First, a little background story on Harmonic Bionics and kind of the genesis of the company and the technology. So one of our co-founders, Dr. Ashish Deshpande, is an associate professor at the University of Texas. He also happens to be the director of the Renew Robotics Lab, which is a big robotics lab at University of Texas here in Austin, which is where we are. I probably failed to mention that. So we're coming live from Austin, Texas. But Dr. Deshpande, his pathway into neurorobotics was actually influenced by his sister, who's an occupational therapist. So one week while he was shadowing his sister, watching her work with patients, primarily stroke patients on this go-around, he said, man, there's got to be a better way. There's got to be a better tool for the therapist and the patient. So this idea or this genesis of a bilateral upper extremity exoskeleton was formed. So he took that idea back to his lab and worked with some of his PhD students and some of his colleagues to interview, design, and develop a prototype for Harmony. And that prototype looked similar, probably not as pretty as the one behind me, but it won many awards and grants, and thus they decided to commercialize the technology. So Dr. Deshpande, along with one of his PhD students at the time, Dr. Mook, one of our other co-founders, took the Harmony technology and formed Harmonic Bionics in 2018. So not long after that, they reached out to Chris Prentice, who's also on this call and will help us field any potential questions at the end here. So they reached out to Chris to run the business side of the company. And Chris came from an extremely well-heralded experience, if you will, from medical device robotics and primarily startups. So you may be familiar with Intuitive and the Da Vinci robot. It's kind of synonymous right now with medical robotics because it's the one that's more ubiquitous out there in the world. So he was there very early before that was the case. And it also, as Franklin mentioned, at Mazor Robotics, which eventually was acquired by Medtronic. So we've got a great group of co-founders from the mechanical and electrical engineering side and a wonderful, also from the business development side. And so we're poised and on the precipice of really launching in 2021, as I mentioned, into those select centers so that we can start to pilot the study and learn how the technology works with different patients and so on. So, okay, now to the star of the show behind me here. So we're gonna focus on early intervention, functional repetition, and intent-based therapy. This is Harmony SHR, our flagship exoskeleton. Harmony is a robotic rehabilitation system that works unilaterally or bilaterally with the patient's upper extremity. The entire system is self-contained within this unit you see behind me here. It sits on three casters, making it very easy to transport. As you can tell by looking at it, the system was designed with the patient in mind, including the ability to fit 95% of the U.S. population. So whether you're working on a 5th percentile female or a 95th percentile male, there are buttons that are hidden throughout the system that allow us to customize the lengths and sizes of the system. So here by pressing a button, I can extend out this forearm piece or retract the forearm piece for a shorter. Likewise, I can do that up here at the upper arm as well. If we're working with a taller patient, perhaps somebody like myself, 6'3", I have the ability to extend this central column vertically towards the ceiling, also down towards the floor. And then lastly, back here at the shoulder scapular complex and your back, we need the ability to widen out laterally or minimize medially for differing shoulder breadths as well. So more kind of moving into kind of the technical components of the technology. So each arm of Harmony has 7 joints for a combined total of 14 degrees of freedom between the two arms.
I'm going to introduce each of those joints, starting out distally at the wrist and work my way back proximally towards the system here. So at the wrist, we have full pronation and supination. At the elbow, we have full flexion and extension. At the shoulder, of course, we get a little bit more complex, but I'm going to break them down into three movements. We have internal rotation and external rotation, as well as flexion and extension. And then abduction, so abduction, abduction, and adduction, adduction as well. I'll move this arm back in. And then back at the scapula, I'm going to hold the arm still. I'm going to raise here. So we have elevation of the scapula. We have depression. And then we have protraction, so into the screen, and retraction back towards me. Now, the shoulder is one of the most common structures affected in these neurological injuries. Its complexity is unrivaled. We have 20 muscles, 3 bones, 3 joints, and 1 articulation. They give it a great dynamic range when we're healthy, but can be challenging, of course, when we're not. Harmony's mechanical structure profiles the natural coordination of the shoulder while enabling our patients to experience greater than 85% of the range in a typical healthy natural shoulder. This particular unit is known as Harmony SHR. So the acronym SHR stands for scapulohumeral rhythm, which is how we move our shoulders. So scapulohumeral rhythm is an important component because it mimics the shoulder and enables our patients to exercise even in those patients that are experiencing a shoulder subluxation. So when the shoulder drops, it supports that shoulder and allows it to move in a healthy manner and not a maladaptive manner. I'm going to place Harmony in home position here. So it's that combination of the shoulder support that I was mentioning and that SHR, scapulohumeral rhythm, which we believe will enable patients to, therapists to initiate earlier rehabilitation on some of those patients, perhaps even those with shoulder subluxation. So I start talking a little bit more about patients and patient integration into the system. So the patient's going to connect in 4 different points. We're going to have 2 at the upper arm and then 2 at the hand. So I mentioned Rohit's going to be my patient today. So I've got to put a couple of attachments onto the patient first. So on the upper arm, we've got just a simple cuff, a C cuff with a little band that's going to wrap around. And then Velcro is going to hold that in place. At the hand, we had a couple of differing alternative options at the hand, but this one that we're going to be using today is going to have a piece that fits across the dorsum or the back of the hand, and then these 2 small paddles that are going to press fit in. So the back of the hand like so, and then these paddles, you can kind of hear them click into place, 1 and 2. What's nice about these is they fit across the thenar and the hypothenar eminence of the palm, so they can help open up the palm a bit. So once those attachments are on, it's now time to introduce the patient into the technology. So I'll have you sit back here. Now, you mentioned 10 years in medical robotic experience, and one thing we know is that even the best robot, if it's not easy to use, it won't be used. And so that's something that we've focused on specifically for therapists and patients as well, is quick setup times. So with those patient attachments, there are 4 points of quick connectivity on both arms. I'm going to check this one here. So there's 3 modes of operation that I'm going to go through today. Number 1 is going to be a pre-programmed exercise. Number 2 will be a weight support mode. And then number 3 will be a bilateral sync therapy. So I'm controlling the system through this pendant back here, which you can kind of see hanging out at the far side of the system. It sits on an articulating arm that can kind of swivel from one side to the other, or we can detach the pendant to wherever it's most convenient for the therapist or caregiver to operate the patient and work with. Or operate the technology and work with the patient. So currently what you're observing of Rohit is he is in a pre-programmed exercise. So in this particular approach, the robotic system is supporting its own weight and the weight of his arm while actively moving his arm through a predetermined range of motion. So he's applying no force, exerting no effort. The system is simply moving his arm through this predetermined range. This pendant allows me to either dial up or dial back the amount of assistance offered by the system in the case of gravity or in the case of assistance or resistance from the system. Currently, there are three example exercises programmed into Harmony. I'll get you another one here. We have the ability to add many, many more. So in speaking with therapists, we've learned that what they call P and F patterns, or we can program those, functional type activities or movements, as well as just general warming up before therapy sessions. I do believe that, or we do believe, that this particular mode of operation will enable even the most impaired patients to exercise, being that it is completely autonomously driven by the system here. So from pre-programmed exercise, I'm going to move into weight support mode. And in weight support mode, it is just as it sounds. It is an active or an active assistive freedom of natural movement without bearing the weight of the robot or the weight of your arm. So he has full autonomy to drive the system bilaterally as he sees fit. So if I asked him to reach up and grab a cup off the shelf, he can reach up and grab a cup off the shelf. Now, just like the pre-programmed exercise, through this pendant, I have the ability to dial up the amount of robotic support or dial it down, not based on gravity like in pre-programmed exercise, rather, but based on the patient's ability to propel or move themselves. So I can dial up the robotic assistance if their impairment is still substantial or dial it back as the patient does get better. Because this is a highly autonomous function or movement, we do believe that it will empower patients to work on more complex activities or functional routines. So you think about maybe grabbing a mirror and brushing your hair. Maybe even utilizing a utensil to bring food from a plate. Or dressing yourself, pulling up pants. Any type of activity, daily living, that may require two hands that you can utilize with this particular function here. So from weight support mode, we're going to move into bilateral sync therapy. So bilateral sync therapy, very unique mode for us. In this particular approach, I have to select a healthy arm. So in this instance, the patient must have a healthy arm, and I have selected his right arm as his healthy arm, which means his left arm is his affected arm. His healthy arm is left in that weight support mode, so he has full autonomy with that right arm. You'll notice that as he moves his right arm, his left arm is actively mirroring every movement or motion that his healthy arm is making. So put into other words, this enables the patients to, number one, communicate, and number two, control the intended motion or their own intended motion of their affected arm by utilizing his healthy arm as a driver. And I think a better way to demonstrate this particular mode is I will detach his affected arm and allow him to continue driving with his healthy arm. So throughout the development of Harmony, one of the defining principles has been that we need to take advantage of the natural coupling in the brain. And we do so by enabling the patient to utilize their healthy arm as a driver and use the healthy arm as a driver and mirror those movements. So this principle is actually backed by previous studies. So there was a study known as the MIME study, or Mirror Image Motion Enabling, it's an acronym. In that study, it utilized two industrial robotic arms to attach to a patient's hands in an end effector fashion. And they tried to move in a very similar fashion as to what you see here. And they found that once the rehabilitation began, that the recovery curve was accelerated and even maintained after therapy sessions had ceased. And so it's our belief that with the improved bilateral sync technology that you see here with Harmony, along with its multi-planar capability, that we could potentially unlock a treatment paradigm in upper body neurorehabilitation. So once the therapy session has ceased, I'll place him back into home mode. System will drag him gently down. As easy as it was to click in, it's much easier to click out. We'll transfer. So early intervention, functional repetition, and intent-based therapy. This is Harmony SHR. I'm not sure how I did on my 12 minutes, Franklin, but I think it's somewhere close.
You did well. You did well, my friend. Okay, we have a few questions. How much core strength do you need to be able to operate?
So it's a great question. So there is some support from those cuffs. Because you're hooked in bilaterally in those cuffs, there is some support of the trunk. However, we do know that there are some patients that will still require some thoracic support. So the technology is made to work with many different types of chairs. And I didn't necessarily dive into this too far, but in our room, we have different types of chairs, with some with lateral support, some with wheelchairs, so that patients, you know, that may lack that trunk support can still have support, lateral support, while they're in the system. It won't affect their ability to use the system.
Okay. And actually that segues into the next question that someone asked is there a way to use the device while you're in the wheelchair?
So in its current design, we've got what's called a T-base, and that's tough to see because we only set up one camera this evening. The T-base will allow manual and, what's the other kind? Manual and
scooters or?
So scooters are where we do have an issue right now. So we don't allow the clearance for a power wheelchair to back into the system. This is something that we've learned in the last 6 months or so. And so we're looking to designing a base that's not the T, but more of an H shape that will allow us a power chair to slide back.
Yeah, I would strongly suggest you folks consider that, because a lot of the quadriplegic population, they use power chairs. So that's a biggie. Okay. Is this being currently used in Austin right now, where you folks are, in any of the facilities? Has this been used at any facility, even on a trial basis?
Yeah, absolutely. It has. So it has gone through trials at St. David's Rehabilitation Hospital, which is a fairly large hospital just beside the University of Texas at Austin. So we've had a partnership with them in the early days, and we've had trials. It's been relatively small patient population, but it's been multi-session, and the initial results were promising.
And currently at St. David's, there's a system there and with the intent to be used for these trials currently. But unfortunately, because of COVID, it's on lockdown right now. But it's funny you should ask, because we just had a doctor reach out to us yesterday about this very thing and having a patient for the system. So we're trying to open those doors back up.
All right. In terms of documenting the effectiveness, what kind of written research has been submitted to any organizations or agencies?
Very little, I can tell you that. So in kind of my intro, I mentioned in 2021, we're going to partner with some thought leaders around the country, and that is our intention. We want them to help direct where those studies go. We don't want to tell them where to go. We want to put it in their hands and let them direct where to go and where they think, you know, different patient bases, how they benefit from different solutions that we're providing. That's the point of 2021, what you just asked.
Okay, next question. What happens when spasticity occurs while using the device?
Yeah, great question. So this was one that I learned coming in. So there's a couple of different ways that you can control robots. And the one I think that many people have in their mind is what's known as position control. So if you think about like a robot on an automotive factory, right, moves in a very rigid and delivers a bolt and goes back and grabs another bolt and delivers. That's not how the human body moves or is intended to move. And so what we use is known as impedance control. And what that feels like is a soft spring whenever you're moving. So actually, when you're in the system, when Rohit's in the system, particularly in the weight support mode, it feels like you're in a pool. If you attempt to move quickly, you feel the resistance from the water. If you move slowly, that resistance is less. So getting on to the question about spasticity, the system moves with this impedance control. And what that means is it feels like a rubber band or a spring is pulling you through the motion. And so if you reach a spasticity or a threshold that is painful or becomes even worse, you know, that's injury prone, the robot doesn't move past that threshold and continue to move you like a position device may. So that's a really important difference, is impedance control versus position control.
Okay. When would be the next sort of, or the first set of clinical trials, and where do you anticipate them to take place?
Oh gosh, Prentice, I might take you off mute for that one.
Chris,
yeah, so the clinical trials, we're in talks with many of the top centers, like Shirley Ryan, the Kessler Institute, Tier Memorial Harmon. So none of them have been locked down yet, but as Robbie mentioned, we've talked with many of them, and we'll be setting the protocols and starting probably in the February, March timeframe.
Okay, very good. Next question. What is the primary diagnosis you see this device for? I know that initially it was meant for stroke patients, but then I think you've sort of understood that a lot of neurological conditions can benefit from this device too. With spinal cord injuries, where do you see this device sort of having the most impact on?
Yeah, Robbie, I could go ahead, and that's no problem. So yes, the genesis of the system was stroke related because of one of the founders having a sister who was an occupational therapist. But the problem, the real problem that has been addressed with the system, is the proper movement of the shoulder. Nothing has been done from an automated fashion historically to move the shoulder appropriately. As Robbie said, you could create a industrial robot to move and have an arm, but it doesn't necessarily move in a human manner. It doesn't have scapulohumeral rhythm. If we move our shoulder in the wrong way, we actually do orthopedic damage to it. So you might have a neurologic issue that now becomes an orthopedic issue. So what we have right now is an upper extremity exercise machine. The question was, what does it apply to? And that's what we'll see as we get it into these rehab centers. There's a multitude of conditions that it would apply for, and from different ways to apply it, of course, meaning that, of course, stroke would be one. What level of spinal cord injury would it go for? Is it for anybody who has a complete spinal cord injury or an incomplete? I'm not going to say, I don't know yet. There's many things that could be done and tested and looked at to see what is it doing for each patient. But then there's also chronic conditions, multiple sclerosis, Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, ALS. There's as we've shown this to the top centers, different conditions have come out, and they'd say, I would use this for this condition, and here's why. But we're going to get the data. We're going to show it out. That's what 2021 is about, is getting it into the hands of the caregivers to find out what is the best application for each disease state.
Okay. Thanks, Chris. Yep. Then this next question might sort of segue into what you were saying. The person is asking, how long would the treatments be developed for? I mean, how would you know how long to set up a treatment plan for every person?
Yeah, it's a great question. Yeah, I think that's going to be developed by the caregivers ultimately when we put it in their hands. You know, they've got an allotment of time with which to work with their patients, and I think in that allotment of time, what they or how they utilize the technology, it's going to be developed by them when they have the experience. It's not something that we can push to them. It's going to be something that they tell us this is how it benefits us.
Okay.
So, yeah, I can't give you a black and white answer on that one.
All right. This next question is from someone who has a C1, C2 injury. They're asking, I have no sensation. How would I know if I'm, you know, hurting myself or not?
That's another great question, and frankly, I don't have the background or the education. I think it would not be behoove any of us to answer that question with any kind of resolute answer. I'm sorry to pass on.
Not a problem. This next question: are you seeing this as a modality in the clinic?
I'm sorry, you may have cut out.
Yeah, are you seeing this as a modality in the clinic?
I think I may need a little bit more of a modality as a...
So this was the same person that asked about, what is a primary diagnosis you see the device for. They're asking if you are seeing this as a modality in the clinic. If you're not certain what the question is pertains to, I'll just move on to the next one.
Specifier, maybe ask it a different manner, and I'd like to get it answered, but I'm
okay. Not. Alrighty. Next question. Would the device intend to provide any patient data for the clinician to evaluate during or after use?
Yeah, so that's another, I love these. I love it that it's so interactive. So the system actually has 81 sensors on board. So each joint has 5 sensors that are built in, 2 for torque, 2 for angle. I could go through it. But the idea here is that they're communicating at a really incredible frequency, 2000 hertz a second. So that's why we're able to do some of the things that we do with the technology. With that also comes the ability to have an immense amount of data. So we're looking at using it not only as a therapy assessment tool, so where a barometer is to where I am today, to where I get to, but also as an assessment tool that we're looking at. Where am I at the very beginning? How am I in the middle? Where am I at the end? So yes, there absolutely is. We have the capability right now to produce data that will help therapists, will help guide their treatment regimen.
So does it measure like muscle fatigue or to better arm the therapist to sort of craft a treatment plan?
Essentially, what we're measuring is movement and force. That's the raw data. But a lot of the research that has happened in the lab at the University of Texas that we were actually born from has gone into inferring topics like fatigue out of these sources of data. That work has been funded from the healthcare standpoint. It's also been funded from NASA and other agencies who are interested in understanding that. So I will say that today it's not going to give high-level metrics like fatigue. It will tell more about strength, about range of motion, how much you have improved from session to session. And as time progresses, when we can make concrete judgments based on the research, we will start rolling out higher metrics like that.
Okay. All right, next question. Can the robot actually augment a patient's desired motion? For example, could it make it easier for you to do a motion like bringing a spoon to your mouth or some motion that has not been predefined? And if so, what is the high-level control strategy for having the robot track and then augment patients' motion?
I'm loving these questions. The answer is yes. There are various modes that we can do it. The one that we have implemented today is essentially gravity compensation or weight support. A lot of the difficulty in many of the activities day to day is just fighting gravity. So just taking the example you said of bringing something from a table to your mouth is the weight of your own arm. So the robot does compensate for that in weight support. And it can be set that such that its neutral is actually pushing upwards a little bit more than the weight of the arm. That is the current setup. We have, again, in the research pipeline, we have more advanced techniques that have not yet made it to Harmony. But as of today, that's what we have.
Okay. We have a couple of OTs on this call.
These are tough questions. I'm enjoying it.
Yeah. All right, next question. So a follow-up to that previous question that about the modality. So the person is an OT and a dear friend of mine. So she says, as an OT, I have a lot of concerns about the muscle imbalance that many tetraplegics have. I'm also concerned about spasticity, sensory loss, and inherent shoulder pain. My question about clinic modality, a treatment tool for the therapist in clinical setting, is your long-term goal for home use, or do you anticipate, and also what do you anticipate the cost of this device to be?
Yeah, okay, there are a lot, there's a little bit to unfurl there. What was the first question?
So is your long-term goal for home use for this device?
Yeah, ultimately, if you look out on in the future, we definitely want to get into home use. So if there's a track to get there, though, right? It goes through inpatient to outpatient to home. We've looked at also gym, but these things are, we're looking into the future five plus years out.
And what do you anticipate the cost of the device to come in at?
Yeah, so there's a couple of different pathways there. We're looking in so whether it's a research system early, we're going to offer a discount to those centers that partner with us early. We're looking in the range of $100,000 to $150,000 a system. When we come out commercially, we're going to be looking at around $250,000 per system.
All right, next question. What is the setup time since the device has to be customized to each patient's unique abilities?
So as Chris mentioned earlier, we were over 70 demonstrations in on the technology, and even before that, of course, lots of conversations. But as I alluded to in the presentation, we can customize to size, we can customize to range of motion, and we can customize to, you know, ability to move themselves. The first time the system sets up, it's going to be about 10, 15 minutes or so, because we have to make all of those manual measurements and then apply them into the system. But the beautiful part is each patient is going to have a unique patient ID. So the second time you come up to the system, you enter in your unique ID, the system knows who you are, automatically resizes, adjusts its range of motion according to what's healthy for you, and then you're off to the races. So first time is going to be a little bit longer, and the second time it would be, you know, one of those very, very quick. And again, that's feedback from OTs, PTs about making sure that we have technology that's easy to use, because they only have a certain amount of time to work with those patients. And we don't want to infringe on setup, you know, making 10 to 15 minutes of setup time. We want them to work on the patient.
Okay. Next question. As with most devices, they could act up or act out. What is the sort of a fail-safe way of ensuring that no injury occurs to the user should the robot malfunction?
Yeah, that's an important one even for us. You know, we can't make it through through the FDA and the things that we need to do if those things aren't built into the system. So there are hard stops on each of the joints, so it won't take you past a normal range of motion for a human. As I mentioned, there are thresholds in that impedance that won't take you through spasticity. As you saw, I mentioned the more hard, the hardware related. Also the quick connects and quick disconnects. As you saw, if it's quick to connect, it's even quicker to take the patient out. On the floor, when I'm operating, there is an emergency stop button. Each of those sensors that I mentioned earlier, the 81 sensors, when you talk about the angle sensors and the force torque sensors, there's a redundancy between those sensors so that if one is not reading what the other is, it automatically brings you back into home mode so that if something, or, you know, even if it's just one sensor's broken, if nothing's happened bad to the technology, it just takes you back to a home mode. So there are, I can continue on and on and on, but there are layers and layers of redundancy for safety.
Okay. Next question. What would the process look like for a clinician to program a new regimen or exercise in the system? Would this also be possible for untrained personnel?
So like maybe a caregiver, I guess, is what you're asking there too. So in that pre-programmed exercise, the first mode I showed, the one that was moving his arm like this, his right arm, and his left arm came across. Those are currently programmed into the system, but what we intend to bring the system with those pre-programmed exercises known as a teach and play mode, so that the caregiver grabs or directs the arm through a trajectory that they wish or they desire for that particular patient, while the system is in a record mode, and once they move it through that trajectory and bring it back, you then push stop, and the system can redundantly bring the arm back through that same trajectory, or both arms. It doesn't have to be one.
Okay. Next question. Do you have a therapist working with you during this development phase to keep things practical and realistic for functional movement?
No, we're just flying by. I'm kidding. Yeah.
Funny yeah. Guy.
We have a couple, I'd say five or six plus, we're probably 10 therapists that are working with us from around the country. And we certainly welcome more. You know, if there's somebody on this call that would like to have a conversation afterwards or just reach out because they want to be a part of this, we certainly welcome that. But we're not moving this thing forward without input from therapists at all.
Excellent. All right, you therapists on the call, you heard that. So just let us know if you're interested in connecting with Robbie and the team. Okay, that concludes all the questions, gentlemen. Thank you so much for your time. And thank you, everyone. As I mentioned at the top of the meeting, we have recorded this presentation. So we'll make it available in the next few days. And those that have registered for the event will get an email from us with a link to the video. And if you have any additional questions that pop into your head, feel free to send them my way, and I'll be sure to forward them on to the folks at Harmonic. So, Robbie, thank you so much for your time, Chris, and everyone else, and enjoy the rest of your evening, and thank you again.
I really appreciate the opportunity, and thank you, guys. Thank you, everyone on the call. Have a wonderful evening, and we'll do a couple of emails.
Yeah, thank you so much. Okay, good night.